Thank you for taking the time to click on Lore. We hope you enjoy the show. Don't forget to like and subscribe here and follow us on Twitch at www.twitch.tv/slipperysteve.
Pop music. And we are back. Lore returns for the final horizon. You haven't seen this campaign in a while, folks. I'm Chris Ferguson, host of the Lore Channel here, and I am blessed to have an amazing team with me, full of high energetic, crazy peeps. We got voice actors, podcasters, theater kids, tabletop nerds, and, you know, 75% of us usually wear glasses on stream. So.
Looking at you, Remy.
I can't leave Remy alone in the non-glasses unit today. I really want to let my bags show today. So anyway, I play Oscar in this campaign. He is the now reformed bard. Human bard, and you can catch me at chrisfergusonvo.com, and I'll drop it down to Mr. Remy, our hype man. Said. I am gonna take 1 second pause here to switch the audio here. I just realized there's a little bit of a change. There we go. Okay. All right, now we're good. We didn't have any music, and it was because I switched the outputs last night by accident.
Well, at least you have your mic on.
Every time you say that, I'm like, do I though?
I mean, we can hear him. That doesn't mean they can hear
yeah.
him.
That was my reminder.
Too many times that's happened on stream now. Sir Bird, aka Colby.
Hello, everyone. You all know me as Bird, who I play here on the Final Horizon. I also play Siloui in our newest game, based in Discworld. And that's most of what I do online. You can find me several places as either Colby Bastion or Lavender Eyes. Right now, this is my online presence, is this game. Other than that, I do various highly nerdy and geeky crafts, and maybe one day you'll be able to get some of them.
Word. Great to have you. James. Oh shit, my system is crashing.
Woohoo!
I am James. I play the Arcane Trickster pilot of the Insanity Sentry Zerzo. I'm also the dungeon master for the new Streaks of Ankh-Morpork Discworld campaign. And you won't find me anywhere else unless you look really hard. And I like that.
I like the pause.
Who are you and how did you find me?
Nah, James, totally. People are gonna like dig up your old like AIM account and like find all your old play-by posts.
Okay. Yeah, go for it. If you can do that, I would love to see them.
Yeah, you will be instant friends. You are. And lo and behold, our current dungeon master for the Final Horizon, Mr. R.P. Davis, aka Bob.
Hello, everyone. My name is Bob. I am your humble and beneficent dungeon master for the Final Horizon. I also play in the games. Thankfully, it's awesome finally get a chance to play in James's game with my stoner fighter. And yeah, you can find me pretty much anywhere. Drive-Thru RPG, DM's Guild, KaboutrGames.com is my game company. So, and BobTheVoice.com if you need someone to talk nice on a project you have coming up. So anyway, yeah, that's me.
Word. Let's get to the little intro that we have, the little video, and then we'll pick up where we left off. If I can find it.
The final horizon. That's what humans called space. They'd explored their own, knew everything about it. Then they stopped looking down and started looking up. Their first toiling steps in space led to worlds close to them. They sent people to places like Earth's moon, Mars, Ganymede, Titan. They sent instruments into the void, searching for other places to explore. For years, the probes found nothing. Then, long after Earth became a footnote in history's books referring to the war that turned it into radioactive slag, the probes found a node, which led to other nodes, which led to 1397 Pegasi. The final horizon is a lot bigger than we thought. An infinite number of worlds. A universe where humans aren't the only creatures that talk and think like an explorer. This is the final horizon.
Scooby-Doo!
Wow.
Please proceed.
For you who aren't aware, that's actually the technical voiceover acting technique to clear out all the junk. So
yeah,
it sounded like nonsense and gibberish, but it was intentional.
Yeah, it was all prep work.
It's halfling for thanks for sticking around, welcome back, and Bob, would you please pick us where
let us recap. Let us recap.
Yes, please.
Yeah, we need it.
Previously on the Final Horizon, our intrepid band of misfits jumped universes from the far, far future to the Forgotten Realms. But not just planet side on the Forgotten Realms. They're still in space. But rather than on a high-tech spaceship with an ion drive and everything like that, they're on a ship called a Dragonfly that is made of wood, has sails that look like a dragonfly's wings, and has a magical chair in it called a spell jamming helm, and with it a spell casting person can cause the ship to hurtle through the cosmos at ludicrous speeds. And in getting to know their new ship, they were attacked by it. The captain's chest turned out to be a mimic. Well, they managed to defeat that. And then they limped the old dragonfly, which they have christened the Insanity, just like their old ship. New ship. Modern. Anyway.
I was gonna say, technically, we never even got to name the old ship.
You no, did. You intention with that.
You painted it on the side. You painted it on the side. And you managed to limp your dragonfly into port on the Rock of Brawl, in orbit in the Tears of Selune, around the high above the planet Toril, on which is Faerun, or the Forgotten Realms. And you, just as I recall, have gotten off the boat and onto the docks, and you're headed through the city.
If I recall correctly, we had gotten off the docks, went in to talk to the portmaster, and were on our way looking for cargo to pick up, but we were going to inspect our cargo first to see if we had it. No, we had found some shit to sell.
Yeah, you guys.
We checked our ship. I have the logs here of everything that we had found.
Yep. Yeah, me too. If you want to, I'll give a real quick rundown.
I have a Google sheet of
the last we found. Left off. You guys were on the ship. I was down with the little dude that sold us the map.
Yeah.
And you guys unveiled the massive amounts of weapon cargo.
Yes. We have to find. I believe I have this written down as well. We have to find the freedom fighting organization whose name, for some reason, I cannot find right now.
Did I even give you that?
You did, because it was in our logs. It was in the logs that Sentry was able to read. That had like the name of the organization we were taking these things to. They're like the. It was some for Dwarven, like, oppositional force.
That rings a bell.
Yeah. So, our cargo was wood, rope, nails, tools, water, wooden flint muskets and pistols, 25 of each, 50 crates, black powder, and lead. Enough for 100 shots each.
Yep.
Would you believe I take notes?
Yeah. I do now!
I hate taking notes. Alright, no, I'm not trying to... I didn't mean to toot my own horn, that sounded stupid. Okay.
Now you got it.
Alright, so we know what that... But, so what did we stop that doing? That's what I'm trying to figure out, is what was the next step? We discovered what we had.
Yeah.
And we know where it's headed, so now we need to go make contact with those people, yes?
I think we all... We also needed to meet back up with the dockmaster to tell them what we actually had on our ship.
Oh, right, because they're going to get cranky because we were like, oh, we don't have anything. And then got back on and we were like, oh, wait, we forgot about all this stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah. Good point.
I'm probably going to have to ask this little guy, like, if he knows, like, is it a problem that we are bringing weapons into port? Like, is that something that is illegal to transport?
Oh, bro, I haven't even thought of that.
Yeah.
Like, I would.
Well, hey, we're lovely, like, merchants. Just kidding. We're fucking arms dealers.
Yeah. Or like, is the group we are selling these to, like, are these guys considered terrorists? And we are, you know, selling.
Who cares?
Them. They care.
Well, they don't know what will hurt them. Let's be honest here for just a second. Look,
technically, Bird is a registered terrorist, so, like, exactly. He doesn't care that much, but...
So, to all the viewers watching, if you're wondering why this is so chaotic right now, it's been like a month since we've been on this campaign.
Yeah.
So, you know... Rusty right. Habits. I imagine
this would be much more of an argument that Elias and Bird would presently be having, though. So,
Who's on the dock with me? Because I'm standing next to Guido Hairyfoot.
Yeah, I believe Sentry and Jor-El had just returned from their meeting with the other of Jor-El's people.
Oh no, Sentry was in the cabin with you guys, standing in the corner, shaking his head, going...
That's true.
Because he was like, by the way, we're like trying to figure things out, and he's like, would you like to use the manifest?
Hey, none of us could read it. There was no way we knew that he could read a random alien language from another dimension.
That's fair.
And yet...
Okay, let me ask this. We're all aware of what's in these crates at this point, right? Because Sentry had shared that information with us.
Yeah, and we had opened a couple of them.
Yeah.
Yes. Okay, so we're aware of what's on that. And so at this point, we're just trying to decide what our best next step is.
All right.
And there is the question of whether or not there would be an issue with...
the legality of our cargo.
Correct.
And were you planning to raise this question with your new friend Guido?
Yeah, that's who I was going to go to.
I'm down there right now with
this dude. Doesn't care.
So
there's some sort of reward for turning in people just like us, then he may care quite a bit. I understand that you may come from a world where honesty is the best policy, but perhaps discretion is the best policy.
this is the discretion, because we need to figure out one way or another. If we try to sell this stuff, those merchants are more likely to turn us in than some random dude on the street. And
the people that the cargo is intended to are the ones that are going to turn us in.
We have to find these people. And if we try to find them and they're a terrorist organization, even finding them is going to probably get us arrested. We need to know more information. So unless you happen to have a random connection in this place that none of us have ever been before.
We need to know more information before we just walk straight out and say, oh look, we have guns for sale.
I'm not gonna tell him we have them. I'm just gonna ask him if these are things. Not gonna hold a neon sign saying I'm selling these things. I just need information.
So your intention is to discover what is legally able to be sold and what isn't.
Yes, get a lay of the land. And
you'll
honest.
Be speaking more in generalized terms and trying your best not to let on to the fact that we've got enough ammunition in this very vehicle to start our own civil war.
Exactly. Not only that, but in my experience, people like Guido out here, they're not looking.
It's so problematic.
I know. I know. I feel so uncomfortable. I'm just going to call him G.
He's got a last name, Colby! Use the last name!
No, that's Lightfoot?
Yes!
Yes. Well, Lightfoot out here.
It's Harryfoot.
Harryfoot, sorry. He's a lot less.
I mean, you can call him Lightfoot in character. I think that would be way better.
Look, he's not. He's not the type to be looking for a huge score. We toss him 5 gold, whatever these are. We're going to toss him some coins. He's not going to say a goddamn thing.
He doesn't even know what's in. He's not even here. He's outside the ship.
I know, but if we start asking him questions and he gets antsy, gold usually calms people down.
Oh,
money works. See? We're good. I've dealt with people like this for far too long.
I'm not going to prison.
Neither
Again.
Am I.
Again. Yeah, thanks, Bob.
Neither am I. Don't worry about that.
I am a man of constant sorrow starts to play in the background. He's got the beard for it.
Oh, we just got a new follower.
Yay!
Ral Productions, thank you.
Hey, I know that guy. Hello, Roy.
All right.
It's R-A-L.
Oi, Roy.
Hi!
So, Mr. Harryfoot,
Yeah, sure, what you got? What can I do for you?
I just have a question. Is it possible that you would be able to tell me where the one would partake in the extracurricular activities? Possibly the more celebratory party type of situations?
So you want a drink, do you?
As a drink, yes. Possibly also, do you know anybody that makes it snow on the nose?
Not sure I follow you, bub.
The nose candy, the booger sugar, and I just start going like this, yeah.
There's all kinds of stuff that you can buy that'll rattle your brain, put worms all the way through it. But say, I know just the place where you might be able to score anything you like.
Yes, that sounds nice, please.
You never been here before, right?
No.
Well, brother, have I got the joint for you. It's called the White Galleon. It's just up the road.
About this time, Sentry, Elias, and Bird would be wandering back off the ship. Sentry, you've probably got the manifest like tucked in a jacket pocket or something, so we have our information we need. Bird would sort of walk his way up to Harryfoot and just be like, all right, we paid you to be our guide for the day, right?
Sure did.
All right. We're going to be going a lot of places.
Sure, buddy, just tell me where you need to go and I'll lead you there.
Well, let's walk and talk.
See, Baird, it is a top priority for us to check out this White Galleon.
Yeah, finest bar in the joint. Wait till you meet Luigi. He's a swell fella.
Ooh, Luigi, he sounds fun.
Right.
Fun, yep. People have called him that.
What kind of crowd?
What do you mean? People drinking, dancing, music.
Sounds good enough. All right, let's find a place to sit. I could use alcohol anyways.
The White Galleon's a place for you. Why don't you follow on behind me?
All right.
Scampers off up the street.
All right. Walking along, I'm sure I have to take like one step for every 10 of his at 6'8". I'm just asking him some questions about like what trade in this place looks like, what all he knows about like how stingy things are, like how strict rules are.
Well, there's only one real rule, Bob. Don't start a fire. Start a fire, they'll throw you out with the garbage. And when I mean throw you out with the garbage, they'll jettison you right off the rock and you'll float through space.
Good to know.
Other than that,
Hoster!
Other than that, don't get dead. Wood's super expensive. Nobody's got horses. Look at the place. It ain't big enough for horses. The only people got any horses is the prince up there on the top of the hill. And he points up and you can see far away on the opposite end of the asteroid. That's what this is. It's a big ass asteroid.
Big asteroid.
it's been a while. On the opposite end from the docks of the asteroid is a palace complex. There's even trees and stuff. But looking around, you see the buildings that are crowded one on top of the other are mostly made of stone. There's very little wood in evidence. Guido goes on to say, yeah, that's wood is about the only thing that you can't really find for cheap up here. Thing would cost you a copper piece planet side. Wow, cost you a gold piece up here because you got to bring it up out of orbit. It's expensive. Water, too. Water ain't cheap. Liquor you can have.
Good to know.
And if you want to buy it, it's probably for sale.
Wait, I mean,
Anything you want. If you want to buy it, it's probably for sale somewhere here in the Rock of Brawl.
The water is more expensive than the liquor?
It's very carefully regulated, you see. There's not the natural supply of water here on the rock is very small. So they supplement it by bringing in ice from the asteroid field, melting it down.
Good to know. Cheap place to get drunk. You should be right at home.
Who, me, mister?
No, why, no.
No, I never touched this stuff. I promised my grandmother.
No, my compatriot over here.
But, the little one.
Yeah, it's good to know, though. So, weapons, drugs, anything like that, easy enough to find?
Oh, yeah, sure.
What about people? Is that off limits?
What, buying and selling people?
Yeah, slaves, things like that.
It doesn't often happen out in the open, but if you know where to look, you can find them.
Oh, it's good to know, at least. All right. Who runs this old rock anyways? I know you said about the prince. What kind of operation is it? How much control does he have?
You want the real story or you want the short version?
Give me a bit of both.
You see, an awful long time ago, there were a bunch of pirates ran around through space. I've just gone from like that 1930s huckster guy to Barack Obama.
Yeah.
bunch of space pirates running around through space.
Gotta check with my constituents.
Anyways, there they were. Couldn't find a place to moor their ships and resupply everything they needed to resupply. So they found this place and they created this town. And it's a swell town, isn't it? But that's the five captains. The five captains still, their families still live here. They still have some kind of control. There's also a bunch of merchant houses. Money talks on the Rock of Brawl. The prince has his hands in everything, but it's all kind of this spider web of intrigue and, wow. The prince has the navy and he has the watch and stuff like that, but if the merchants decide that the prince doesn't get any more supplies, well, he's out of luck. So, the politics, the situation is fluid.
Not quite a figurehead, but definitely not in control.
You don't want to tell him that to his face, but it's not likely you'll ever meet him anyway. So, and as you're walking along, people of, like I mentioned before in the last session, you see beings of all different shapes and sizes. The super tall hippo-faced soldier, you know, dressed like soldiers in ornate uniforms. They're walking around. There's a bunch of them. There's elves, there's dwarves, there's halflings, there's gnomes, there's people who look like Jor-El, there's clutch of mind flayers walks by and headed toward the docks from the city, and no one's even given the time of day. They're just walking along like normal people. You can even see there's a platoon-sized group of orcs that are heavily armed and just walking around, and no one is killing each other officially. It just seems like this is all, you know, the place you want to go when you need to get something done, and no one wants to start a war. The wars don't come here.
Good to know. What
supplied and funded here?
Yeah. Well, judging off of what I've heard so far, it feels to me like there's not too much tension. So I'm gonna ask him about what was the name of the group that we were supposed to be bringing these weapons to?
Anybody?
Mr. Note Taker.
Yeah, I don't have that one either.
Yeah, that's like the one note we didn't take. It was like
note taker, take me a note.
They're like the opposition force to some for Dwarven Kingdom or something. Or
here's an idea.
Yeah,
why don't you ask Sentry?
I'm asking Bob.
Who's clearly not choosing to answer you for a reason.
Yeah.
And so...
But if I ask Sentry, James, you don't know the name. You don't have it written down, do you? No. That's why I'm asking Bob.
Okay,
so...
I'm asking the dungeon
master. All right. I got it.
Let me try this a different way. Bert, can you hand me the manifest, please?
Yes.
Thank you. Excuse me, Sentry. Can you tell me what the fuck this says? And who we're supposed to take these to?
Remy, this is out of character. No one knows the name. That's the problem.
Actually knew the name because he could read the manifest. That's the problem.
But the problem was none of us knew the name out of character.
The delivery...
This in-character issue.
The delivery is... the manifest says that the delivery is to be made to... person by the name of Fargram Bitterspine.
Yes. Someone write it down. Everyone write it down. Where's my notes?
Not an organization, but a person called Fargram Bitterspine.
Yes.
How does one find out their spine is bitter?
In a place called the Citadel.
That's what it was. The Citadel. And then I think it was like, I think there had been like a history check or something that I think you had made, Elias, that told us about what was going on there. And that's where we got the information.
Yeah, the Citadel is a Dwarven mining outpost in the Tears of Selune.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
Yes, so that's right, because I felt like an immediate connection to all this bullshit.
Yep. So, are we still walking with Guide... I keep saying Guide Harryfoot. Guido Harryfoot. It makes sense.
Guido and Guide. Guido all the Guide. One.
Yep. And
convenient, isn't it?
Are we almost there? My feet are hurting.
Oh, sure. It's just up the road here. And sure enough, about a half a block away, up on the right, is... Where the hell? I have the wrong window open. It's off the major streets. He's led you kind of in a bit of a maze, has Mr. Guido. In between Armada Street and Man of War Street, the exterior is, you know, kind of nondescript. It doesn't, you know, it's not like there's ornate, you know, lights and everything announcing that it's a tavern that all the awesome stuff happens at. But there is light spilling out from the interior onto the cobbled streets. And through the windows, there are people eating and drinking and making merry. And as you approach, as you get nearer, you can hear music coming from inside.
You guys, Sentry, are you guys okay? You all look like you've seen a ghost.
A ghost?
A ghost. Really new. Whole lot happening. I'm used to new, but today was really new. Alright, so let's...
So
let's,
there's a... What? Maybe... What? What was it? You find something on your sheep or something? Meta.
Yeah, us. We found us on this ship. That was the day. So,
Bird, based on the information you've gotten so far, are we going to talk to them, or are we just going to go forward?
Well, I think we're going to get a few drinks, then we're going to head back, get our cargo squared away with the dockmasters, and then head to whatever this citadel is. And
you want to go
from there.
You want to go back to the dockmaster smelling of alcohol?
Because that's not normal.
This sounds like something that we should quietly have a conversation about. Very important, like, and then I fuck off.
To
the I'm looking for
nose
candy.
Any illicit substance.
Yeah. And booze and something to hook up with.
That's all right. It's all right here in the galleon.
Yep. Oh, I know. I'm just looking for it.
Yub-nub.
Nub-nub. Okay. Yep, I will get my hands on whatever nose treats I can find and get boozed up and try to find something to score with.
All right.
Well, it is a wretched hive of scum and villainy. It is the interior of it is actually very nice, of the White Galleon, that is. It's roomy and comfortable, and it's brightly lit, unlike many taverns that are, well, that you've never seen because you're not from here, are you? There are oil lamps casting a lovely golden light over the scene. There is a minstrel strumming some sort of stringed instrument on a low dais on the opposite end of the large common room, away from the door.
Nice.
And inside, seated around tables, are people of all descriptions. There's a mind flayer playing a dice game with a dwarf and an elf. There's a couple of those hippo-faced chaps up against the bar doing shots of something that smells like rocket fuel.
Whew.
You can smell it from here. And there's humans and elves, and it's just a mix of everybody you can possibly think of, and some you can't. And seeing you standing in a doorway, the oddest thing, though, because Guido says, well, come on in. Let's find an open table. There's bound to be one around here somewhere. And he waves at the bartender, which is a giant eyeball with other eyeballs on stalks, like 8 of them. Mm-hmm. And the giant eyeball in the center of the rubbery sphere over a wide mouth that's filled with needle-sharp teeth. And you can see the eye stalks, the secondary eye stalks, are doing things like maneuvering glasses and pouring drinks and cleaning the bar top all at the same time. And Guido says, hey, Luigi, brought you some visitors. New people here on the Rock.
I told him I'd show
him a good time.
Yeah, I duck behind, and he's smaller than me, so I'm crouched now behind Harryfoot, and I'm... Is this Luigi?
Sure, Luigi's a swell fella.
I'm just
stand-up guy.
Poke, and just do one of these.
And out of the big eye swivels to see you, and he laughs. Come in, gentlemen, come in, have a seat, have a drink. What can we do for you here at the White Galleon?
Don't you?
Do you have any, God damn it, Harryfoot, where can I find the bigger cigar in the... I need to alter my mind.
Ah, say, here, just leave it to me. Slip me some coin, and I'll see what I can track down for you.
How much is some?
Call it 50 dragons.
What the shit is that?
You're really not from around here, are you, pal? Dragons. It's coin about yay big around. Made of gold.
50 gold?
We only have 60 gold.
Yeah.
I know.
This sounds like a lot of money.
Bird's eyes go wide. Like, my eyes are as large as Harryfoot right now.
Oh, yeah. Never mind. I just start fumbling around in my pockets to see if there's any lint or something that feels familiar.
You find a piece of string.
Yes. I will have a drink, please.
Sure, let's go over here. Let's sit over here at this table. You can watch some of the local color. And there's a round table near the minstrel. On your making your way to that table, you see seated at a smaller table near the big front bay window, there's an extremely tall, blue-skinned person just kind of quietly surveying.
Blue-skinned tall?
Blue-skinned and tall.
Fuck off ponytail, we're going to do that.
Say again?
They don't have like a big fuck off ponytail and a loincloth, do they?
No. Okay. No.
I was gonna say, we're crossing streets, you're bad, hold on.
No, not that far.
Well, I will continue my search for at least the getting laid part of Oscar's mission, and then I'll just kinda like chill in the back.
Okay.
The worst shenanigans Elias is likely to get into in this place is just to grab himself a drink and keep his eyes open.
I'm gonna have a drink or two and settle up, watch a couple of dice or card games and see what's going on.
All right, yeah, the card games are nothing. The cards don't even look like anything you're familiar with.
Yeah,
I mean, dice games are dice, but the cards have things like dragons and other kinds of weird monsters that you vaguely remember from stories you were told as a child. Mm-hmm. And the coins are, there's flashes of gold and silver. Something might probably, if you recognize him, Bird, as platinum. And gems of all different shapes, colors, and sizes are also in the ante piles on these various games. Someone has just thrown a piece of rotten fruit at the minstrel, who takes his stringed instrument and spins it around and bats it right back at the person playing a game of cricket, to which the whole place uproarious applause. And Guido says, yeah, it's a fun game. We play that all the time around here. It's called Pelt the Minstrel.
That's a game I certainly don't want to get good at.
A tray full of drinks brings itself over to your table and sets down in the center of it. And Guido, or Luigi, over behind the bar. Elias, you, in the back of your head, you hear this voice, with the compliments of the house.
This fucker's talking to me in my head all the time. Goodness.
And Guido disappears for a second. He scampers off, and he's going up to that table that the blue-skinned person is sitting at. And they whisper together for a few moments, and then Guido comes scampering back over, and fellas, gather around. You see that Vidalkin over there? Over there in the corner?
Blue chap, yes. Over there?
Yeah, the blue skin. That's what we call a Vidalkin.
Okay.
Anyhow, some people call them the Arcane. They're the ones who know things nobody else knows. They know how to make the spell jamming helms. They're really, really clever. Now that one goes by the name of Uvlish. And Uvlish, don't tell anyone I told you, got a lot of pull in this town. Well, Uvlish says, wants to talk to you.
Can I see, what kind of sense am I getting off of Harry Foot? Is this like, am I walking into a threatening conversation, a friendly one? Like,
he's really, really excited.
Okay.
There's a question mark over his head.
Yeah.
Khajiit has wares if you have coin.
Do we all want to walk over? Do we want just one of
us? He'll come to you if you want.
Sentry, Bird, why don't you both go over?
Small crowd. Small crowd moving makes for less attention.
Why don't the two of you go over, Elias?
You notice that this person has easily 2 meters of space in, like, this bubble around them.
Okay.
Where the rest of the white galleon is very much packed with people.
Who all wants to go over and have a conversation?
I am.
You fellas stay right here. I'll bring over to you.
Much appreciated.
Great.
And with that, it's a good point to take a break.
Yeah.
Yeah, fair enough. 11 o'clock. All right. We'll do a 10-minute break and we'll be right back, guys.
All
right. Incoming transmission.
Name's Bird. I've been dragged through war, did my time in the mines. Now, I got pulled into sending people to the same fate. So I decided to take my life back. No more giving it away. And yet, I'm serving time for all the mistakes that got made. And not nearly all of them are mine.
Bonjour, it is I, the magnificent Oscar Pierre Pelletier.
You look at me like I am a Rostopactyl. No, this is all part of my fantastic plan. Does the Rostopactyl star in every film on the planet Magawan? No. I may have some, you say, weaknesses, the booger sugar, makings of, gambling. Perhaps I took it a little too far and got myself in trouble on 23. Ah, the Golden Hive has nothing on me. This is all part of my magnificent training as a galaxy's best actor. Au revoir.
This is your Captain Sentry Zerzo speaking. If you can all stop nubbing around and get your butts and your seats strapped in, we'll go ahead and get this show on the road because, you know, the folks that own the ship are going to notice any minute now that I'm up here trying to take it. So, let me see if I can get this arm turned first. That'll probably help make the trip a whole lot easier for everyone, huh? Okay, everybody strapped in? Good. Time to go. See you. Bye.
My name is Elias. I wander in search of the secrets that planets alive and dead hold. The greatest mystery that I work to unravel? Why my brothers and sisters slumber while I remain awake. I am a star wrapped in flesh and wandering.
What is lore?
What is lore?
What is lore?
Lore is a group of amazing creative people.
Pure. Unbridled.
Shenanigans.
A league of rolling expeditioners.
Who have come together to play tabletop role-playing games.
Voice actors, theater kids, musicians, pop culture fans, content creators, tabletop nerds alike.
Which, personally, are some of my favorite things to do.
My favorite thing to do.
And pretty early on in the process, we came together and we decided that we were going to share our experiences with you all.
Streaming live play D&D on Twitch.
And anyone else who wants to watch and listen and experience it with us. And to that end, we've all come together and we are all creating amazing things.
Homebrewed from scratch content.
Between art and videos and scripts and just the game that we're playing, and not just one. We have our primary game, The Final Horizon, that is space fantasy.
By R.P. Davis.
But we also have other games that we're working on.
James's Discworld campaign.
So many amazing things that we're going to be producing in the future, and we can't wait.
We can't wait.
For you all to join along with us. So, what is lore?
What is lore?
What is lore?
It's amazing people sharing our amazing experiences with more amazing people.
Welcome to your first day as an employee of Halcyon Corporation at our Alcor 3 mining facility at Hadir 4. You must be as excited as us for you to contribute to the most profitable mineral extraction operation in the sector. Halcyon takes pride in the safety of our facilities, with 14 hours since the last injury or death on site. To reinforce safety, do not be alarmed by the presence of armed security personnel. The Strikers are here for your protection. It has been 0 hours since the last injury or death on site. Have a good day, and remember, Halcyon is here for you.
Halcyon Corporation is not responsible for the death, injury, or missings of any employee, personnel, or cyborg.
Elias, mysterious man from the sky, running for star of the show.
I swear to see, I will burn every tree down on this planet if they kill our... I don't know why I'm feeling super protective over this galaxy.
Promises to burn down every tree on the planet, but what does he do?
I'm gonna try to sneak out of the ship.
Exactly. Runs like a little bitch.
God damn it!
Potty mouth.
Mm-hmm.
In space, no one can smell you stink, but they can smell your awesome. If they don't smell your awesome, they know they smell loser. Hatchet body spray smells like awesome. If you can't smell like your own awesome, get Hatchet. Hatchet scents run the gamut from awesome to
more awesome.
Awesome astral punch. Punch your nostrils in the nostrils.
Awesome.
Mega moon doom. Zero gravity.
All doom awesome.
Savage supernova. All the fury of a dying star in your armpits.
Awesome.
Not enough awesome for you? Well, you're wrong. Think you're as awesome as Hatchet? You're even more wrong. The most wrong. But don't be wrong, be awesome! Hatchet Body Spray.
In every shape or form, does Hatchet Body Spray assure you that you'll be awesome, more awesome, or the awesomest?
Welcome to the streets of Ankh-Morpork, or more importantly, welcome to the Special Investigation Unit, the most modern police force on the disc. In the grand tradition of Terry Pratchett's novels of the Discworld, this 5th edition Dungeons & Dragons campaign will be a satirical look at modern life using the police procedural formula used by television shows like CSI, NCIS, and yes, even Brooklyn Nine-Nine and Reno 911. It's meant to be silly, irreverent, and maybe even poke some fun at ourselves along the way. So join us the first Sunday of each month on Twitch as we create our own stories in one of the most fantastic fantasy settings ever dreamt of, Terry Pratchett's Discworld.
And we're live. We are back. I'm going to adjust Bob's camera while he talks. So...
what now?
Bear with me here. I'm just gonna work on your camera while you get us back into...
Right. So before the break, the intrepid crew of Misfits had made their way through the city on the Rock of Wall, coming up from the docks toward, through the warehouses and the shops and the marketplaces, teeming with people, all the way to the White Galleon, led by their native guide, Vito Harryfoot, into the White Galleon Inn and Tavern, owned and operated by Luigi, who is a really rather urbane, well-traveled, and nice beholder. And watching some games of chance, playing cards, playing some dice games, watched the game of Pelt the Minstrel, where the minstrel actually cracked one out of the park back at the thrower. And Guido had mentioned that the blue-skinned person you saw sitting at a table alone had a proposition for you. And you invited the blue-skinned person to your table. And then the blue-skinned person appeared and sat down.
All right. Cue blue-skinned person.
Hiya.
Yay.
Are you well?
Wolves can be. I extend a hand to Uvlish. Uvlish, was it?
It's Uvlish.
Ulich, all right.
Oh no, Ulich.
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 I don't know if I'm actually saying it wrong or if it's just the camera delay. So
Cass is back.
Ulich. I don't know if I can make that sound.
Ulich.
It's all right. It's all right. You're fine.
Well,
pleasure
to make your acquaintance.
So what?
What is the proper term for the booger sugar around here? Ulich.
Say that again.
I'm looking for the...
Our friend wants some drugs.
helping me out here. I'm looking to some mind-altering substances.
Is Mr. Harryfoot still nearby? Because I'm pretty certain that he had offered to grab him something.
Oh yeah, 50 gold. Oh, that's right. I did.
Oh yes, Mr.
Here we go.
Yeah, Guido is right there.
Yep. So retroact. Where does one partake in the
carnal activities?
Yes.
Oh, well, what flavor strikes you?
A little of this, a little of that.
Boy, girl, in between, tentacles, no tentacles, fur.
It's been a while. I don't care.
Wow. Open mind. You'll fit in well here.
Wait, I'm going to keep my eyes open. Please continue.
Oh, if you want, I can take you.
Sure.
Got a cousin.
I'll go. I'll fuck off.
My cousin Giuseppe. Yeah, Oscar and Guido.
He sounds magnificent.
So Oscar and Guido go off to the place of negotiable affection, leaving the rest, the other three of you, here at in the bar with Ublech.
Ublech.
It's news to me.
Is that mocking? Are you doing mocking?
No.
It's not very nice.
It's the three of us and Ulech.
Ulech.
It's candid now.
Would you like to introduce yourselves? I motioned to Sentry and Elias. Remy, you are muted.
I noticed.
Yeah.
It is nice to meet you. I will do my best to pronounce your name. I make no promises. Ulech.
That's well proper. Well, Papa.
Thank you. It's very nice to meet you. What is it that interested you in our table?
Well, I heard that you were lush.
Sentry? Would you like to introduce yourself to our new friend?
I was just going to go look for a sandwich, but okay. Yeah, you call me Sentry. How you doing?
Pleased to meet you.
So don't mind these two jaggos over here.
Thank you for apologizing for us, as usual. What can we do for you?
I'm looking for someone, see. He's... Megan! Megan! Megan Evans!
What? Yes, here, mistress.
What's the name of Jones the Dwarf?
That's
Megan!
It's Mr. Bitterspine. Mr. Bitterspine.
Is Jones the Dwarf? I want you to find Jones the Dwarf for me. It is very important.
Jones the Dwarf.
Whose name is Mr. Bitterspine. Mr. Thargram Bitterspine.
Jones.
Well, we're certainly able to do that, I hope. Is this a difficult gentleman to find?
Obviously, she's going to be asking us to help her.
Yes! If I can do it myself, why would I ask you?
I mean, we are.
I mean, what is occurring?
We have very little clue of that ourselves. We are here for only a few hours so far, and it's our first time, so.
I see.
What is your need to have this gentleman found?
I want you to bring me this gentleman. Well, this dwarf. In 2 days' time.
Need he be alive?
Yes.
Well, that may come at a slightly higher price, but I'm sure we're up to the task. What sort of information can you give us? Do you have a lead on where he might be?
He's in a place called the Citadel.
Ah, we've heard of the Citadel, haven't we?
It's come up in conversation so far.
Who hasn't? Yes. Is there anything we need to know about the Citadel? Barriers to entry? Anything along those lines?
That is not mine. That is your job. I'm not going to do your job for you.
That's fair. Just trying to gather all the necessary information.
Is Mr. Bitterspine there willingly, unwillingly?
I'm not going to do your job for you. You have to find him for me.
Okay, good to know. Well,
what is the expected payment upon delivery within 2 days' time?
I will give you 250 Wartavian dragoons each.
Is Harry Foot still around?
No, he pissed off with Oscar to the whorehouse.
Fuck it, okay. Just a moment, please. And I want to huddle with the team.
Yeah.
I'm still not 100% sure what the hell that even means, but it seems like it's a fair sum considering the price of booger sugar was 50.
Yeah, and considering that everything we found in that chest was... less than 200. 250 a pop is pretty good.
I agree. Okay, so we're in?
I mean, we're looking for this fella already, so...
Yes, can't. Perhaps that a little bit louder. Sentry.
I figured we...
How do you close a deal with the folks of this race?
They like this. And Sentry just sort of pokes his head up out of the huddle and goes, it's a deal. We'll go find him for you.
That's well, Lush.
Okay.
Now, if you excuse me, I'm going to take care of this minstrel up here because he sucks. I'm going to get some real music in this place. And I just get up and walk up to the dais and, like, look at the minstrel and go, gimme.
So, you're going to play?
Yeah. Absolutely.
Holy shit.
I'm going to take my aviator's helmet off and turn it upside down at the front of the dais. You know.
First of all, make a charisma persuasion check.
Oh, man. Okay.
Because the minstrel's kind of looking at you like,
How does a nat 20 with the plus 8 persuasion go across there?
Yeah, all right, let me tune it for you. Hold on.
Damn.
He hands you the loot. L-U-T-E.
So she's sitting on like a stool or something like that?
Yeah.
I see her. Okay, Jago, out of the way. Yeah, you take the move.
Play free bird.
Yeah, you free bird.
Yeah, Bird would request that.
After he gets done tuning it, sit down and I start going like clang, 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 clang. I'm tightening stuff up to play with the tune.
Ding, 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 ping.
And then actually like go start like tuning it different and then like go right back to where it was.
Okay.
Do you know anything by the Goo Goo Dolls?
Hold on a second here. See what I can do. So, yeah, I'll start playing.
Oh, God.
The puns.
Sound world to ease my troubled mind. You're wearing a Superman t-shirt, dude.
wearing a Superman t-shirt. Okay.
That's the only Google Dolls song I know.
with my plus two to performance, I rolled a 16.
Yeah, you're doing okay. The audience's person is kind of going, what the fuck is this guy doing? But then, you know, you manage not to break any strings.
Yeah.
And you get through the first two and the audience is kind of...
Okay.
I don't want the world to see me. Because I don't think they understand
what I am.
Broken.
Wow. One more line and we will never be able to afford anything ever again.
Speak no evil.
Alright. No evil. There's a guy, Luigi is looking, you know, turned a couple of eye stalks toward you. And there's a raised eyebrow on the end of that eye stalk.
I gotta make a name for myself here.
Make another check. Performance.
Okay. Let's see what we can do.
Guys, we lost a party member to a bar.
There's a 19.
We're gonna find a new pilot.
Yeah.
Yeah, you're killing it. You're killing it.
Did we just become roadies?
Yeah.
They're all my roadies now.
Nice.
I mean, Oscar will fit right in. He's already fucked off to brothels and drugs. Like.
Yep.
Now
this is his lifestyle.
When he needs to chuck a TV through a hotel room window. Wow.
Yeah. La Resistance.
As I'm playing, you know, looking down at my pilot's, my aviator's helmet, going like, you know, looking out to everybody like, hey, here, Jagos, I'm not doing this for
What's
free.
What's your armor class?
14.
Remy, roll me a d20, add 5.
Oh boy.
Is Remy throwing a, Eli's throwing a bottle at him.
15.
15. Pelt the Minstrel has begun.
Oh.
Sentry. Yes. Make me a dexterity saving throw.
This is fantastic.
20.
You dodge the piece of rotten fruit that someone lobbed from the audience.
Okay.
Everybody roll initiative.
Perfect.
All right. Well, as I'm playing, and I'll weave it into the.
I'm actually going to join in.
What, throwing food?
Yep.
Yeah. So PvP begins.
No, dirty 20! Dirty 20!
Okay, Sentry. A piece of a rotten tomato splats on the middle of your chest.
Ooh.
Yes! Bullseye!
Let's backtrack where that came from.
Dem's fighting. Dem's fighting fruits.
There is your sandwich!
And woven into the lyrics of the song I'm doing, I cast grease right under Elias.
Well, you know what? We don't have to have the PvP Battle Royale this month. It's going down right now. Okay. Everybody pick your charity.
Now that means that he has to make a dex save if he moves, right? Or fall down?
No, he just has to make a dex save or he falls over.
Okay. Just period.
You know what?
You just slip right out of your chair.
Yeah, so does Zubafa.
Me and my dex save with a bit of 15?
Yeah, what's your save, Sentry?
What's my save?
It's the DC.
Spell save.
Oh, it's a dex 12.
I made it.
Yeah, but you ain't gonna be winding up no time soon.
That's true.
Bird is has worked his way through his own drink and is now just drinking the other 4 free drinks that were brought to the table.
Yeah, the eye twitch.
While everyone's distracted.
There it is, the classic bird twitch.
All
I'm gonna keep playing. I don't care. You guys suck.
Well,
So Oscar will be, I guess, talking to Harry Foot on the search for love.
Yeah, you're about two blocks away, in front of a brightly lit building. There are windows, large windows, in the front of it, on either side of the front door, and there are creatures of various descriptions. There's a human woman, an elven man, there's a dwarf, because the beard obscures everything.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a what looks a rubbery mass of tentacles.
Okay.
And there's a sign saying, come in here.
Low-hanging fruit. I will go in. Is this the place, yeah?
Yes, sir, this is the place. Come, Guido Harryfoot sent you.
Is there, like, a cover charge for the door? You know, walking in, or you have to pay something?
I wouldn't know, mister. I've never been inside.
I will go in.
All right, you go in, and it's just dripping with red velvet and, gaudy brass furnishings and everything. And again, there are workers of various shapes, sizes, descriptions, and genders strewn about the place. And an enormous fat man in a chaise lounge wearing a Speedo and pasties. Hello, darling! A customer!
Au revoir.
How can we be of service?
Hi, Hedonism Bot.
Oh, bonjour. It is I, Oscar Pialetia. I am looking to partake in the lovemaking this evening.
Well, what kind of merrymaking would you like to engage
in? I'm really glad that he didn't dress up today.
I am physically hurt by that.
I was interested in knowing what your prices was first before I considered making a choice.
Well, the tickling twist is 5 dragons. The bareback shuffles 15. And the world-renowned bend-over-backwards, half-flip, double-somersault into the jello pool is a full 30.
The one that you said was for 5. I will partake in that adventure.
The tickling
twist.
What sort of partner would you like to engage?
Something tall, dark, and handsome.
Tall, dark, and handsome, eh? And he claps his hands, and a line of tall, dark, and handsome.
Yep.
Comes out from a doorway. There's a human, an elf, a gif, and another of the blue-skinned Vidalkin.
Okay.
It's Vidalkin, but it's pronounced Welsh.
I will look at them all, and I will say, which one of you enjoys partaking in mind-altering substances? And I will just wait for the first to raise their hand.
The elf raises.
That one. Right there. That one.
Splendid!
Take that one.
Says the fat, mostly naked man. The rest of you, be gone! And the elf is standing there and winks off. that it's like...
Bonjour. It is I, Oscar Pierre Pialetier, the galaxy's best actor.
Whatever you say, honey.
Prepare to be pleasured like you've never been pleasured before.
Yeah, all right. Let's go upstairs.
And see.
Back at the White Galleon.
While various shenanigans are happening, Bird's just going to start. He's already been floating around watching games and whatnot. He's going to start dicing with some people and chatting them up, trying to get some information.
There's a fight about to kick off. Just so you're saying, just so you know.
A fight?
Oh, yeah. There's fruit flying. And people are, the chairs are starting to be shoved back. Tables are starting to move.
Okay, so it has surpassed fun and games, and people are getting rowdy.
Yeah.
Okay.
What kind of beings am I hiring for my job? This is not appropriate, is it?
You hired eclectic. That's all I can say.
Eclectic is a word you could use.
Megan! Yes, Megan!
Yes, mistress.
What does eclectic mean?
It means varied.
Shut up, Megan!
Yes. All right. I'm just at this point still. I'm sort of limbering up in case the bar fight happens.
Oh, it's gonna happen.
Beings! Do you want the job or not?
Oh yeah, no, we'll take it.
You have 2 days, see? 2 days.
That should be plenty.
No more than 2 days, and 2 days from my planet, not 2 days from somewhere else.
Is that different from 2 days here?
I am too important to be doing conversions for you.
Ah! All right, we'll figure it out.
Lush? Papa Lush.
Papa Lush.
I feel like you're being called a lush, but you're maybe translating it as like, yes, greetings, thank you.
Yeah, no. Bird is just doing his best.
I think Colby's doing his best too.
You're not wrong.
Can go see. Why are you still hanging around here? You can go.
This is our table.
And?
I think she wants us to get started on the job.
Yeah, we will then, but I'm still drinking. I've got two more of these to go.
he's gotta calm that eye twitch.
I'll hurry this along, don't worry.
Oh yeah, sentry. Dex save.
Dex save?
Yep.
Everybody was bar food fighting.
Oh no, 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 no. Bad. Rocks fall, Oscar dies.
Hey, that's a very new way of getting your rocks off, I guess.
Yeah. Bye, everybody.
I'm gonna be angry if I get hit with a pasty.
So,
modified with my +5 to my dex, I got a 23.
Yeah, you're dodging fruit, meat pies.
Fucking Neo up there.
Sausages in a bun.
I'm going full on Matrix on him here. Okay.
So make another performance check with disadvantage.
Uh, 19.
All right. Yeah, you managed to hold it together. You don't fall apart in the course in the bridge of wagon wheel. And okay. You just keep
I'm motioning to the two knuckleheads. I'm trying to, like, hopefully getting their attention and doing this, like, motioning to the door for them. You know, like, start heading out, and I down. Break into ballroom blitz.
Oh, my God.
I on that note, I shotgun my last drink, slam it down, and say, pleasure to meet you. And I'm beelining it for the door.
Yeah.
Damn.
Get out! Out!
And as I'm playing, I'm
making not speak
the door
Welsh?
With the loot and my aviator helmet and everything. Just making my way out.
Nice. All right, James, roll me percentile dice.
We have a new bard.
Straight 30.
That's how many silver pieces are ended up in your helmet.
Awesome.
An extra 3 gold, that ain't bad.
Megan!
Yes, mm-hmm. Yes, mistress.
Megan Evans!
Yes, mistress.
Throw them out!
Oh, no, mistress, they've left already. Ladies and gentlemen, Cash McGann.
Woo!
Get out, be gone. Do it now.
I'm gonna go wash my face.
You're gonna go wash your face now.
Right. Nice. Man,
she's been looking forward to that for 2 weeks.
Awesome.
I mean, I that was so good.
All right,
I got 30 silver and a loot. Nice.
Oh shit! I can't believe you just walked out with the minstrel's loot.
Fuck.
I'm just seeing him as the cabbage guy from Avatar. My loot!
Late laugh, sorry.
All right, so. Oh, turning that off, don't need it. I am not blue, I don't need the light.
All right, yeah,
So Oscar is nowhere to be found.
Yeah, I guess. Just waiting on. I was gonna say, do we see Harryfoot around anywhere?
Make a perception roll.
Okay.
Or investigation, whichever you prefer.
Okay.
I'll give you a hint. Look down.
17.
Yeah, you see him threading his way through the crowd, coming back toward the White Galleon.
Gotcha. I'm gonna sort of motion him over and be like, "All right, where'd our friend end up? We gotta reconvene at some point."
Yep, very well. I know exactly where he is. Follow me.
All
right. Leads you back up the street toward the. Tickle and Shake House. And, just walks right in through the front door and he says, "Hey, mister, that fella, we came in here, little fella, which room did he go into?" And the pimp goes, "Ew, he's having a delightful time in room 2B.
2B or not 2B?
I'm just...
Ooh, definitely to me.
I am parking myself in the lobby and waiting patiently.
Okay.
I'm not walking in on whatever that is.
No, same.
I'm walking up to the door of 2B and just standing outside kicking it.
Oscar, inside you hear this do, 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 do.
Oh.
And, all right, to be fair, that's probably the sound that was already going on in the room, and it's just blending in.
Well,
Who is it? What do you want? I'm busy.
Are you done giving that hooker chlamydia? Come on, let's go.
Oh, I am so insulted, Sentry. I dare you. I will come to that door and punch you right in the face.
I just keep kicking the door. Dun, dun, dun. Come on. You can't get any more STDs. Let's go.
I throw my clothes on. Come on. And I open the door.
And Sentry just stands with a goofy grin on his face holding a loot.
I'll just open the door.
Bonjour.
So, what the... Okay, fine. I look back and blow a little kiss to the whatever it was that I was romping with.
Yeah, the elf in tall boots with a riding crop. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Don't forget Oscar.
Yeah, okay, buddy.
Okay.
Thanks for the pair of pliers.
So about what time of the day is it right now? Or night?
It is space.
Helpful.
You can see Realm Space's star, its sun, is visible around the on the other side of the planet. The side of the planet facing you is dark. But there doesn't seem to be any effect on the citizenry of the Rocket Wall.
Is the Citadel located here on this asteroid, or is it down on planet side?
Who are you asking this?
I wasn't sure if that was something we would already know. I'm asking you.
At the far end of the Tears of Saloon.
Cool.
Way out yonder.
So once we get everybody back together, I suppose it would be appropriate to discuss whether or not we're going to take off right away, or if anybody needs a nap.
Oscar's following everybody, but he looks like he's been riding a horse all day with that walk. Just
All right. I'm just turn to Harry Foot, and I'm like, all right, where? Can you tell me a little about the Citadel?
Oh, sure, pal. What do you need to know?
Anything you got.
Well, how familiar are you with the mining of asteroids?
Surprisingly.
Oh, well then, I don't need to tell you much. Citadel's where most of the miners congregate after they've been out prospecting amongst the asteroids and mining for stuff. That's where they come back to resupply.
Particular turmoil or conflicts going on amongst or within or around the Citadel recently?
Oh, there's all kinds of stuff always going on out there. But I heard tell recently that there's a new movement going on out there. Don't know the truth of it, but it's like they're trying to organize out there. The miners trying to organize themselves to see if they can't negotiate for better wages, things like that.
That sounds like my kind of business. So, where would this Citadel be?
It's about, just about a day's flight, I should think.
Well,
a little less than a day to get out there, a little less than a day to get back.
Right, well, can you direct us?
Yeah, sure. Just go up here. Just see that line of asteroids going out there? Like, and there's this trail, this glittering trail, like the tail of a comet. Because the Rock of Brawl is nestled in the Tears of Selune, which trails off of Selune, the moon.
Selune!
So, get out of here! Mm-hmm. Your job's done. So Rock and Brawl is much closer to Salune than the other end of the tiers. But the comet-like tail of the asteroid belt is very long indeed, and the citadel is not even halfway through it. It tries to keep itself centrally located.
All right.
Century, you mind telling me why you look like a walking sandwich?
Oh yeah, Century, you're just plastered with food.
I just hold up the loot because of this.
Transformation has begun.
A mini guitar. How nice.
Well, I think our best plan of action at this point is to try to get ourselves to this citadel, figure out what's going on there.
Wait, for what?
Yeah, figure out how long the Vidalkin Bay was.
Wait a minute.
I turned to Harryfoot. Hey, how long's a Vidalkin Day?
Same as everybody else's.
Okay, that's what I figured.
Then I suppose with the distance involved, we should get moving immediately.
Pretty much.
So what is going on now?
We've been contracted to take possession of one Jones the Dwarf, who just so happens to be the contact that we were already looking for. So now not only are we going to get paid when we find him, we'll be paid for bringing him back.
You talking about the Bitterspine guy?
Yes.
Yep.
Oh yeah.
How fortuitous.
Tall, dark, and handsome told me he was a very important person. Not like, you know, in one ear out the other, but some things stick with me.
Good to know. So he should be easy enough to find then.
Yeah, he's right under this rock.
Here's the open.
I used to live there.
All right, well, we've got our...
We lived in a lake.
We've made some merry. We've got some information. Let's get on out of here.
Say, you need me to lead you back down to the docks? You think you can find your own way?
No, we paid you for the day. Might as well get a little more conversation out of you.
Why, gee, that's swell. Happy to oblige.
All right. Well, as we make our way down to the ship and get ready to shove off, anything new?
Who are you talking to, Baird?
Just everybody. Anybody else got plans or?
I mean, I would have liked to find some booger sugar, you know, but was there any gambling at the place? A galleon?
There are some dice, some cards, but not too much.
That sounds good to me, as long as there's a possibility. Century, you smell really bad, and that's a lot coming from me.
You talk funny. I just go bounding up onto the insanity, you know, with the loot over my shoulder like Negan's baseball bat, you know.
Nice.
All right, guys. Sam. I mean,
just remember, half your shit's mine.
I
guess we'll be part company, friends.
I know I need a rest.
Thank you very much. It's you've been helpful. Really appreciate it.
Anything to oblige. Any next time you come into port, well, I'll find you.
Right. See you later.
There is one small thing that
We haven't yet completed.
Oh, I thought we'd... Yeah. Five gold.
Well.
There we are.
Pleasure doing business with you.
There we are. Give him his gold. Yep.
Clink, clink.
Clink, clink.
Up in the upper left-hand corner of the screen appears minus 5 gold.
King.
All right.
So, did you guys have a good time at the bar?
It was good.
It was very boring here.
Oh. Danny! Look, you can eat your master now. He is a sandwich.
He looks delicious, yes?
Yeah. You should probably eat him.
Well, that would be rude if not done with invitation.
Go on, Sentry.
He's looking up his rock. There is a document. I dropped the link to in the Discord earlier this afternoon.
Yes.
That explains things like how the ships work and stuff. And now I have lost it. Is this it? This is not it. I am a dope. Never mind me. There it is. Flying a spell jamming ship. Right. For routine things like leaving the rocket brawl, you don't need to make a check. But for things like navigate, plotting a course, blah, 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 it requires a check. There is also the speed is important because that depends on the spell slot you sacrifice to power the helm. That really isn't all that important right now because that's more for tactical speed than it is for cruising speed, the hyper speed sort of thing. So, So Sentry, plotting your course, make your helm check, and in order to make this helm check, you will be rolling a d20, adding your spellcasting ability modifier, your proficiency bonus, and your helm modifier. Your ship has a +2 helm. You want to make a note of that.
Okay.
So make that check while we take a break for a wee-wee.
Wee-wee! All right, we'll be back in like 5 minutes, peeps. All right, we're back. Thanks for sticking around, everybody. I just want to take a real quick reminder. We have a Patreon, and the links are down below. We also have Jadez's father's GoFundMe still running down in the charity events tab. You can donate there directly. You can donate to this channel as well to help us if you don't want to do a monthly tier pro plan with Patreon. So, yeah, not the best plug, but hey, want to get it out there. NC.
Right. So what, Sentry, what did you get for that check?
What did you get here?
Okay. Yep. That is plenty good to lock in a course and fire your dragonfly off through the tiers of Salune. And the helm gives your senses this, it sharpens them up, Sentry. You can sense things out for hundreds of thousands of miles, which is good because space is very, very, very big. And every asteroid in the asteroid field, you can very clearly see. You can thread your way. You don't have to thread your way through them because you've managed to make a nice big, what's the word I'm looking for? Not ballistic arc.
Anyways, big old curve. You're curving it. So you don't have to go through the middle of the asteroid field. It is an uneventful journey. Oh, yeah, you all had a chance to do the rest thing, so not that I think burn ass spell slot. But your calculations, Sentry, bring you out of your spell jamming speed abruptly, and the glittering panoply of the Tears of Selune are all about you. It's just like diamonds in the sky, man. It's gorgeous. Oh, wait, I'm sorry. I'm breaking into Burly from last week. But anyhow.
Wow.
Wow, man. And rapidly approaching, because even though you're not traveling at your hyperspace speed, you're still going pretty damn quick. Is what can only be described as a stone-stepped pyramid. Like someone took an asteroid and carved it into a stepped pyramid like those commonly found in Central America, in our world.
Okay. And
the closer you get to it, you realize it's gigantic. You can see ships going to and fro. There are lights glittering through apertures in the stone surface, perhaps windows. And on each of the pyramid's four sides are arched openings big enough to accept ships like yours.
All right. I assume we can find a pretty easy place to dock.
Yes, I suppose you can.
All right.
You can always try.
Yeah, Sentry, can you bring this thing in?
Please, I can do this with my eyes closed. Come on.
All right.
Here comes that one.
Yeah, you don't need to make a check just to approach this place. It's the closer you get, the more you realize that you could drive four dragonflies abreast into one of these arched openings in the side of the pyramid. You're not likely to hit anything.
I could do it with my eyes closed. There you go.
I'm going to put my headphones back on.
Look it up.
My laptop fan was really loud.
I thought somebody was running the vacuum.
So, I will walk up to Elias. So, buddy, what the... What went down at the galleon?
I'm not sure what you mean.
Well, I went to go pleasure.
You went to scratch some itches, yes.
And yeah, and so you know, I come back and Century looks like a sandwich, and now we are looking.
Oh, we all threw fruits and vegetables at him. It was a good time, playing a game called Pelt the Minstrel.
Oh, so Century is a minstrel now?
No, but he fancies himself one.
Does he need a tampon?
God damn it.
Beat him with the loot when I see him.
No.
Okay.
Minstrel.
One who plays an instrument.
He plays a lute.
Okay, I get it.
I believe you.
So, not dampen. I will put that away.
We were also hired for a job, as I explained on our way back to the ship, and it seems as though we're preparing to dock at the Citadel.
Oh. This is news to me. Okay, good. Adventuring.
Yes.
And thankfully, the gentleman we're looking for, this Bitterspine is the one who we're supposed to be meeting up to sell all the cargo we've got. So, if we hit one bird, if we throw one stone, we should hit two birds. Is what I'm trying to say.
But
there are only one of you.
Yeah. I was going to say,
we should be able to get both these jobs done in one shot.
Okay.
Two birds, one stone. I can't be the only one who knows that adage.
I think it is ringing a bell. I think it was a movie I saw one time at Mega One.
Gotcha. Yep. Nope. Okay. All right.
James just shakes his head.
Rising country bumpkin.
Are you bringing the ship inside?
Yes. Yeah. Piling it into the not foreboding at all giant carved step pyramid asteroid thing.
Coming inside, the interior is very brightly lit. You're in a tunnel, a tube that heads arrow straight from the exterior to the somewhere deep in the bowels of the Citadel. And this thing is as big as a city. The underside of the pyramid is, the best way to describe it is if you take a mountain, rip it out of the ground, flip it over, and then build a pyramid on top. That's essentially what it is. And
sounds good.
Yeah, and there are light sources of bluish white light on the interior of these tunnels, and ships are leaving, ships are going in. Traffic is fairly heavy. There are many ships your size. There are ships that look like yours. There are ships that look like kind of like hammerhead sharks, like a stylized hammerhead shark.
Ooh.
There are some that look like old-fashioned three-masted sailing ships from long, long, long ago. Moving, flying along. They've even got sails set. And eventually, after a little while puttering along down this corridor, it opens into a cavern that must be miles across. That's perfectly spherical. And all around the periphery of this spherical cavern are docking points. And ships are mooring to these docking points. They're dropping away from these docking points. And the other tunnel entrances that lead to the other sides of the pyramid all feed into this one big space. And the ship ahead of you just makes its way up and to the right toward an empty berth. There are empty berths around.
I suppose just find a close one and pull in, dock it.
All right. Easily enough done. You pull alongside, and magical ropes twist out from the quayside and make fast to the stanchions, bow and stern of your dragonfly. And it lights up with a numeral. 7.
Okay.
7. Number 7.
All right.
So, new place, huh, guys?
Yeah. All right, well, I suppose first thing we're going to need to do is get a hold of whatever dock mess there is and check in, see what cargo we've got to offload, and try to find this Bitterspine gentleman.
You guys mentioned before that we have a bunch of weapons on the ship?
Yeah.
What are we doing with it?
Well, everything seemed pretty kosher on Rock Brawl, but I don't know if this place is going to be a little more stingy about it, so I think, I don't even know if we're going to be doing a deal directly here or not, so I think we should just dock our ship, not plan on unloading anything, and then we can update later if we need to.
Okay. Well, let's go. Allons-y.
All right. Yeah, gonna call after a dockmaster if we can find one.
There are along ashore, as it were, there are workers pushing carts. Some have raw ore on them. Others have crates and barrels of presumably finished goods. It's very, very busy. And the place is just a hive of activity. The workers are dressed in dirty gray overalls, and they are almost entirely dwarfs.
Okay.
Anybody see?
I start looking at my thingy on my wrist, see if I can possibly do something.
I got deep speech.
Hey, pardon! Excuse me!
One of the workers looks up.
And we are looking to dock our ship. Could we get some assistance, please? I push a button and I pull up a little GIF of a ship docking. Like this.
But...
Dock, Jago.
You already did.
Don't mind my friend here. He's a little slow. Hey, where's the dockmaster?
Oh, you go down here to the end, up the stairs to the right.
All right, thanks. What's your name?
It's not important.
All right, I'll just call you Lonnie. Hey, have a good one. Let's go take it off up the stairs.
Hey, speaking of, are we taking Donnie with us?
Donnie's secure.
I mean, can't hurt. Don't want to leave the poor fella on the ship all the time.
Is your friend Sentry?
Gerald is content to stay on ship.
Okay.
I'll bring you a sandwich.
Hey, not a problem.
Friend appreciates sandwich. Extra poupon. Please.
I'm gonna do something really dumb. So I'm gonna pull up this little thing, and it's like an emoji that says like high five, and summon Mage Hand. And I don't know how it works, so I don't even realize, like, oh, but he's okay. Take me down, and I like try to like climb on it, because I don't understand anything that's going on with why I have spells all of a sudden.
Yeah, your mage hand
take me down
is not strong enough to bear your weight.
And
as you climb on it, you just sink to the floor. I mean, not fast enough to hurt you, but if you fell any farther than just kind of climbing on it, Yeah, you would probably suffer an injury.
Yeah. Okay.
Like, you ever sit down on an office chair where the cylinder isn't set right and you just slam down suddenly? It's like that.
Like this.
Yep.
Yeah.
I embarrassed get up. You see, guys, this was a practice of the actor arts called sitcom.
Are you just comedy? All right.
Well, sit. Come on, we gotta get something figured out here.
Yeah. Okay. Following you guys.
All right. Set up. Find the dock master.
Yeah. Following the dwarf's directions, you can't help but notice that all around you are these gray coverall-clad dwarfs. Some of them have numbers and letter combinations painted or drawn, written on the backs and fronts of their coveralls. And the letter number combinations correspond to the piers that they're working on. So,
all right.
For example, your particular dock is F7.
Okay.
So there are some workers with like F5, F12, that kind of thing.
Gotcha.
And following the only people who aren't dressed very shabbily and who are not dwarves, you see a couple of elves in very ornate uniforms. There's a squad of the hippo-faced mercenaries with their guns. They appear to be in charge. They're watching everybody very closely. There are some humans dressed in very fine clothing, laughing and joking amongst themselves, in stark contrast to the dwarfs who look, their eyes are all downcast, and you haven't seen any joking, laughing, nothing but work, hard work.
Do I get the sense that this is like prison labor kind of situation?
No, it doesn't appear to be under, it just appears to be a really shitty job.
Okay.
Like there's nobody, you know, pull any cool hand Luke shit. They're not wearing shackles or anything like that.
Okay.
Dirty hard-boiled eggs.
Don't you ever talk that way to me again. Ever?
Brilliant movie.
Alright, I'm gonna find a dwarf named Gaston for his 4 dozen eggs. No. Yeah.
Nobody carries cargo like Gaston.
All right, so we've got Doc Master here. Pull on in.
Yep. Doc Master is human.
All right.
Oh.
With a, he's got an array of scrolls and parchments and papers in front of him. Welcome to the Citadel. What berth?
We're in F7, down here.
All right, F7, scratch the thing. Name of the ship?
That's the Insanity.
Cargo?
I just take the manifest and lay it on the counter here.
Oh, we are so fucked!
It's legitimate cargo as far as I'm concerned.
That doesn't matter! Oh my god.
Nice. I like it. I love it, James.
We'll figure out the rules here eventually.
We're gonna figure them out right goddamn now!
Looks like it.
I love Bob's face too.
I legit am not sure where to go now.
I thought the plan was not to declare things. We talked about this.
I love it.
Could I possibly sleight of hand it away from him before he lays it down? I don't know, man.
James, hat off to you, sir. I love it. The chaos.
All I know is we were hired to bring this stuff here. I don't ask questions. I just bring the cargo and get paid.
He's not wrong.
I'm gonna need you to wait right here.
Absolutely.
I'll be back in just a few minutes. And he takes the manifest and he goes out through a door behind the counter.
Well, and he,
looking over your shoulder.
Bird is just sitting there.
The eye is twitching.
Just both. Like eye pinch and forehead grab just
Bird. Bird.
Bird!
Do you have any of your firearms on you?
Yep. Yes, I do.
Are they loaded?
Always.
Oh, goody!
Alright, I'm real glad we didn't bring Jarell with us now.
I swear, if this goes sideways, I may just kill you myself, Sentry.
Oh no, I don't know who's been through kindergarten, but there's these things called shapes, and right now ours is a pair.
Eloquently put.
Y'all getting worried about nothing. Just relax, play along.
Man comes back through the door with your manifest and another looks like a human in midnight blue robes, liberally embroidered with stars and moons and purple horseshoes and shit. And
hearts, stars and horseshoes, clovers and blue moons.
See the new Lucky Charms mascot, I was wondering?
Yeah.
Behind those two are two of the burly giant hippo men. Dudes.
Real quick, Oscar will say, bonjour. It is Oscar Pelletier. This is our Captain Sentry right over here, Dab.
Dab.
Dad.
Is that like Yub-Nub?
No, somebody cheered in the chat and it's a thing.
Dab.
It's a thing, is it? I should probably watch the chat. I don't.
Oh, yeah, you don't need to. It's a dark and dreary place.
it's pretty great.
Yeah, it's awesome.
Nice. Okay. And the Dockmaster says, do you know the consignee for this cargo?
I told you, people say this is the cargo, this is where it goes, I bring it.
So you've never met?
No. I couldn't tell him from anyone else.
Stand by just a second here. I need to look something up. Because I forgot to look it up before.
I think we just got somebody murdered.
I'm sorry.
I need all of you to make charisma saving throws.
Charisma saving throws.
Okay. Nat 20 plus 2, 22.
Sometimes I really hate you, James.
Dirty 20.
Oh, fuck off. I got a nat 20 also.
No. What the hell?
What?
Of course, I rolled a 1.
So when the zone of truth comes down...
Oh, God.
Oscar, you feel strangely compelled to tell the honest, unvarnished truth. The other three of you are not affected.
Guys, it is. Is it a little hot in here, Olivison? Like,
where did you? The man said that the wizard who cast the spell says,
"Where did you get this cargo?"
the weather, right? We got another ship and we all of a sudden came out of here for no reason, and then we got a whole bunch of boxes and I wasn't even there, and then they told me exactly, you know, that there was a whole bunch of guns and powder and stuff and ammo, and I don't know what's going on. Oh, it's Goosey. So, I look at everybody like, did I just fucking say that?
You didn't buy this cargo.
Huh. You're just delivering it.
For whom?
Fuck if we know.
You don't...
Spying whatever thing.
We're just here to make the delivery and get paid.
So who is paying you to deliver these things?
Payment for goods upon delivery then, yeah?
Somebody.
Guys, I am really scaroused right now.
Come with me.
Look, Oscar, do you know who we're delivering this for?
No, I do not know anything.
Do we know?
Do you?
No.
Okay, then. I would believe the ancient tongue of English would describe this situation as we are fucked.
I mean, I...
Not necessarily, says the wizard.
All I know is we're supposed to deliver all this stuff, and then we're picking up a passenger. That's all I know.
There is one way that you can, how should we put it, unfuck this situation?
Oh, he speaks our tongue.
I'm a man of many talents. Now listen to me. Make your rendezvous with this bitterspine. But you will be watched and followed. And all you need to do is get out of the way once you have made contact. Is that understood?
No. I'm in the zone of truth.
Crystal. Crystal clear.
Please ignore Excellent. Our friend here. He enjoys a bit of the booger sugar.
That is a phrase unknown to me. Never mind.
Okay.
Very good.
All right. So, I guess you'll be seeing us.
Oh, yes. But you will not be seeing us.
That's delightfully creepy.
Expected no less. All right, let's shove off. And I grab Sentry by the collar and drag him out. And I grab the manifest as well.
I need to make a copy of that.
No, you don't.
Have a nice day too, thank you.
I just
wow.
We walk out, and
I want you guys to know. I am completely seat to the pantsing here. You fuckers better be taking notes because I'm not going to remember any of this.
Yeah.
I don't even know this dude's name.
We didn't ask.
Didn't give it to you.
Yeah,
and true. Thank God you didn't, because I would have had to go to fantasynamegenerators.com.
Plug.
Bird literally just sits on the ground, sits against the building, pulls his knees to his chest, and rocks for a minute. Just... Sentry, what the fuck? That wasn't the plan.
Plans. They're overrated.
When they keep you out of prison!
We may have just doomed an entire I mean,
stop. We have no idea who's continuing to listen to us. We are not in any way in safe territory to begin tearing him a new asshole, which he very much deserves.
Well, I think we're just about out of options right now, so...
Regardless, we're going to meet with Bitterspine. What we do afterwards...
I guess we'll find out.
I guess we'll find out.
All right. Still have no fucking idea where this dude's gonna be. All right. Find the nearest... I'm going to look around for the seediest looking building that I can spot that looks like it serves a hard alcohol and ask somebody about this dude.
There is a promenade of shops along the along the inside of this sphere. Like it crisscrosses kind of like lines on a globe.
Okay.
You know, longitude and latitude lines.
Yeah.
That are basically walkways. And gravity changes depending on the orientation of that walkway. And because each ship has its own gravity plane, each docking area has a gravity plane that matches the level of the dock. So when you walk out, it gets a little weird when you turn a corner. But once you get used to that, it's fine. Matter of fact, everybody make for me dexterity saving throws.
Oh, damn it.
30-20.
Working on it. Something's funky.
16.
11. Because I am rolling... Remember this one, Bob? For the camera. That was Milo's one that he always rolled low on, and it continues.
Yeah.
15.
Yeah, none of you fall over, but it is a little disconcerting the first time you take a corner when the gravity plane changes.
Ooh, buddy. Ooh.
Somebody say, yeah. Bubby.
Don't bring up that gritty level nightmare again.
We're gonna be best friends forever.
No. No, we are not.
Sorry, side reeling.
You can see like flashing magically lit signs that say things like duty free.
Duty. And,
maximum allowed by law, sort of thing. And there are plenty of bars, restaurants, cafes, you name it.
I believe that's for you, Bird.
Yep. Going to a bar. Darkest, dingiest one I can find.
Okay.
Feels like home.
It is very... The one you chose is the dingiest one. You passed... six or seven of them before you found one that was suitably dingy. And entering therein, there's very little illumination. There are some lanterns that are mostly shuttered, throwing a fitful light around the place. There's a dirty bar, a surly looking dwarf bartender in one of these gray jumpsuits. And his is numbered P3. And none of the customers are these dwarves in the gray jumpsuits. Various other, you know, elf, some gnomes with, you know, gears falling out of their pockets and stuff like that. And what in the back, seated by himself, is one of the GIF, the large hippo-headed humanoids, trying without success to remain inconspicuous.
He's just like the Ninja Turtles wearing a trench coat, just very clearly.
It's I don't know if you've ever seen a Secret Service agent trying to look casual.
But they've got like that straight back, like way too tense look, eyeing everything.
Yeah. Even though they're wearing a Hawaiian shirt and khakis. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. Going to look around, find a game of dice or cards and ask if I can join.
All right.
Something low stakes.
I will join you. Oscar is going to, in on that shit.
Yeah.
Like, you see Oscar start twitching, like,
Nice.
I'm sitting down, throwing a couple, hopefully, copper and on the pots, whatever people are playing with, and just going to be asking questions, trying to get some info, see if I can figure out the lay of the land, and if I can ask after this Bitterspine, if anybody knows about him.
Okay. Yeah, you walk up to a table and throw a couple coins in to the pile in the center. So how are you asking? Like, just gonna blurt it right out? You gonna pull a sentry or what?
Nah, just asking around what's, like, asking about what's going on in the Citadel, happenings and whatnot, asking about people's jobs, how they've been, that sort of thing. New in town, trying to get a lay of the land. I heard talk of a fella named Bitterspine, who was told I could meet up with him for some work.
Okay. The conversation flows. You know, people are a little like, fuck is this chatty new guy? When you first, when you first sit down and start asking, directing a conversation, you come to find out that there has been some unrest in the last few weeks on the Citadel.
Okay.
The workers have started to, where before they seemed perfectly fine with their lot in life, they have become less satisfied with it.
Okay.
And there's rumors of an organization that's behind this, though no one at the table really knows anything beyond that, something is going to happen soon. And at the mention of the name Bitterspine, everyone just clams up. Nope. Don't know nothing.
Oh. Well,
I see some poker faces at the table now.
Yeah. My poker face, my poker face.
Also searching for a dwarf, and there seem to be quite a few here, who goes by the name Jones.
Come again?
Jones the dwarf?
Never heard of him. Oh, wait! Isn't that what the Vidalkin calls everybody when they can't remember their name?
That would make very good sense, yes. Yes. Yeah.
Jones the bartender, Jones the dwarf, Jones the pilot.
That's just that out of my notes now.
That's just Philip. That's just the Vidalkin version of John. Them
it's
Johns.
It's a very Welsh thing, you see.
Gotcha.
There's a joke about a Soviet agent who went into Wales. And he was looking for a deep cover spy on the coal mining industry. And yeah, this Soviet agent was very highly trained, had the actually spoke Welsh, and went into this small Welsh mining town and starts describing the man he was sent to find. And the bartender says, ah, it's Jones the spy you're after. But anyway, because it, yeah, it's John. It's yeah. John. That John there.
Well,
get it. Love it.
Oh, man.
So yes, that's what Cass was referring to.
Yeah.
Okay, well, now that I've caught up.
Although it was entertaining, and I shall tell her about this, and she will laugh.
She heard the joke, and the joke was good.
All right. Yes.
I was surveying the room as the conversation was taking place. Was there anybody who discreetly attempted to slip out when the name Bitterspine was mentioned?
Make a perception check.
Don't mind if I do.
Can I assist with that?
Or not unless you're openly talking about it.
I was going to say, well, I was the one who talked about it, so.
No, I mean, the two of you comparing notes, did you see anyone slip out? No, did you see anyone slip out? So.
Well, I guess, can I make my own discreet check?
Of course.
Okay.
I got a 10.
A what?
A 10.
You'd, yeah.
I got a 17.
You still didn't, yeah.
Very good.
You did notice, Colby, the bartender's ears perk up a bit.
Okay.
And he's peering at you very intently.
Okay. Does it seem to be antagonistic or just interested?
Just paying attention.
Okay. I'm gonna go up and go up to the bar and get a drink.
What can I do for you?
I could use a drink. Can you mix me something up? Something extra bitter?
Well played, Colby. The dwarf. Reckon I might try. And he pulls some bottles out. And right. Sets them on the bar.
Gotcha.
And give me just a second. I have to consult my notes.
Meanwhile, Oscar's going to look at Century. Are you getting in on this?
I'm good. Century's like sitting there going through like a little PDA thing. Just like, I'm good. Thanks.
All right. Ante up, you sons of bitches. It's time to lose all your money.
And, as the dwarf is mixing your drink, Colby, he picks up the different bottles that he's chosen from the back shelf and puts them down. Yeah, he pours, and he puts them down. He gives you a look as he spins the labels toward you so you can see them.
Mm-hmm. What do they read?
Among other things, they read out Dr. Bagum's apothecary. Those are the words that leap out to you. And he kind of raises an eyebrow at you as he slides the frosty cold mug.
I take a sip.
Make a constitution saving throw.
Saw that coming.
13.
Okay, you feel a little queasy.
This was not a mix of alcohols that was intended to be consumed.
This is not. Yeah, this is a cocktail to send a message.
Yeah.
He's kind of.
And just the tiny. Okay.
As dwarves can show he goes pale.
Yeah.
Behind that, because he's basically.
Yeah.
A pair of eyes and a nose.
Yeah.
I sit, of beard.
I sit it back down and I say, "That's good. I like the recipe. I'll
have to find somewhere else that can make this for me. Have a good day. And I place a gold on the table.
Thank you very much, sir. That's not me.
What is that? Nope, that's me. Sorry. I turned it off.
Fucking ice cream truck.
Yeah. I got it. Sorry. I slide a gold across the counter.
Oh, you have a level of exhaustion, Colby.
Oh, boy. Okay.
Yeah, Bird has a level of exhaustion.
That's disadvantage on checks?
Yep.
Skill checks?
Disadvantage on literally everything.
Oh, does the exhaustion hit saves and attacks and stuff too?
Oh, yeah.
Ah, I didn't think so. Okay.
Unless I'm horribly mistaken, I'm going to look it up before chat explodes.
Yep. All right. So I walk over slightly green and burping.
Ah, disadvantage on ability checks.
Yeah.
And attack rolls is level 3 exhaustion.
Gotcha. All right. Let's
smoking.
All right. Well, I think we're ready to get on out of here. So, thank you all, gentlemen. And how has Oscar been doing as far as gambling goes?
You know, let's find out.
Yeah.
Let's find out. Give me half a tick, y'all. That's not the right window. I'm opening the wrong shit. Here we go. Doo 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 doo.
I usually have a deck of cards laying right here too, but oh well.
All right, we're gonna play a game called 38s.
Oh shit!
Everyone who wants to play can ante in. It's a 1 gold piece ante.
Okay.
The goal of this is to get the highest number. 38 beats everything because you're rolling a d20, a d12, and a d6.
Okay.
You get a 38, you beat everything, right? A 3 beats everything else. So a 1, a 1, and a 1. Other than that, highest number wins.
20, 10, and 8?
20, 12, and 8. So you ante in, you roll your d20, then we do a round of bets, you know, raise, calls, whatever. And then everyone rolls a d12, repeat betting. Everyone rolls a d6, then a final round of betting before the reveal.
Gotcha.
So I will roll for the other players. So...
why does that keep happening?
Oh, we rolling now?
If you want to play, yeah.
Yeah,
so roll roll your 20, get your results.
Okay. All 3 at once?
Nope.
Okay.
Just the 20.
Just the 20.
Just the 20. Keep it secret.
Okay.
Keep it secret.
Oscar's going to lean, put his wrist down and open up his text message and use sending to Bird.
Okay. And
what is the sending going to say?
It's going to say, "Hey Bird, I am trying to win, so please let me know what you have. You can reply to this message."
Beep.
You have one message.
Luck of the draw. Play your own dice.
Ooh.
Yep.
Born. It's a sick born. Sure, it is a sick born.
You just wait till I learn how to use this mage hand.
Okay, let's go round the ring. Sentry, are you playing?
No, Sentry is flipping through his PDA.
Okay. Bird.
Yeah, I'm in.
All right, Ray, raise.
Yep.
Call. What?
I'll call. So, raise another one.
Okay. Elias.
I'm in. I'm calling.
The other, the local, what are my results? Says, all right, call and I'll raise you 2 gold.
I'll match that.
Sure.
And that means Oscar.
Yep. Oscar's going to give a very cocky look. 2 gold. I'll match it.
All okay. Right. Now it's 12 time.
Okay.
And same story, Bird.
If I match, does it match the 2 that was raised before?
No, you've already thrown in on that.
Okay, so it would be back to 1?
Yep.
I'll do...
You can raise however much you like.
I'll do 2 this time.
Very well. Local throws in the 2.
Mm-hmm.
Elias?
I'll match.
All right.
Local says, you seem pretty... Be confident, but so am I. I'll raise you 5.
I'll match.
I'm out.
How about you, little man?
Big talk is usually for big losers. I will see your 5 and raise you 5 more.
Very well. I'll call that. How about you, big man?
I'll put in the 5.
Oh, shit.
Nice. Time for the D6.
One second.
Is it D6 or D8?
6.
Okay, sorry.
Wait. Ah. Wait, it's a D6?
Yeah.
Not a D8? Oh.
Nope, D6.
Okay. That's
20, 12, and 6.
Yep. Okay.
Your lead, big man.
Raise 10.
Oh, shit!
I can look at my results here because... So wait, that means we're at 10 plus 4 plus 4.
Plus 5.
Plus 5. So 18 plus 5 is 23, and you're putting up another 10.
Yeah.
For 33.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Local man says, all right, I'll call it. How about you, little man?
I will match and throw another 5 on top of that.
All right, I need a fucking calculator.
So that's 38 apiece.
Yep.
That's so much, and this is gold?
Yeah.
And
you don't even have that much if you lose.
No, we do. It's just a lot of it.
No. See, there's the key. We do.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What do you say?
You don't.
No, yeah, no, we collectively have this.
Yeah, but see, isn't part of that.
Oh yeah. None of us have Sentry has 3 gold. That's the extent of his money. That's all the money
gold than that.
It's all in credits. Yeah. It's all in credits.
Yeah.
Okay. Yep. I bet you there's some metal that costs something in there.
Alright. Alright, new meat. Show him. What's your total?
31.
31?
Yep.
Beats my 26.
I'm so glad I folded.
How about you, little man?
25.
25?
You were only off by 1 from him, but no, I got 31.
Yep.
I rolled a 12 and an 8 on my last 2, or a 12 and a 6 on my last 2 dice.
Nice.
And the first one was a 13, so I was already doing pretty good.
So yeah, you're up like 120 gold.
Yep.
And your local man says, pleasure. gets up and walks out. And that, I think, is where we will wrap up for this session.
Good call. A little bit of dice rolling and winning some gold. Hey, Baird, good job. We are splitting that, right? You know, because half of that was my gold that you took.
I give him his share back, and the rest, is collective funds. Don't worry.
Let's just split it amongst the party.
We got it all saved up. I've got to add it in here. So that's another 38 gold for the group. So that's
38 times four.
Well, some of that was ours already.
Yeah, true. And I have no idea how you're going to split that out. Don't care.
I got it. Don't worry. I've got an Excel spreadsheet with coordinated
what?
Numbers. Oh yeah. Look, I told you when I do like cargo and like trading games, I do them.
Okay, listen,
values
listen,
and coordinated
listen.
Numbers.
I have one instruction for you. Go meet a woman. Jesus.
Should we observe a moment of silence?
For Alex Trebek?
My girlfriend, who apparently doesn't exist anymore.
Oh, shit. I forgot all of...
Who is asleep in the bedroom above me.
Both?
Why not both?
Right on. Well done, everybody. Thank you, Bob.
Good session. Thank you for throwing me the curve there in the middle of it. That was fun.
God damn it, James.
Yeah.
Love it,
don't
James.
Don't worry, you Jagos. I got a plan.
All right.
Always. Plans. Says the guy that says plans.
That's exactly it. I'm going to make it up as I go along.
Doesn't mean it's not a plan. It just means it isn't well thought out.
Yeah. I'm making some preparations to try to, you know, take in all the different, you know, variables and whatnot. And, you know.
Oh yeah, no, I've definitely formulated a plan for what to do here, but it's gonna be interesting.
So thank you everybody for sticking around and watching. Thank you so much to our new follower Raul Productions, and thank you again, Sheets Junkie, for being our first patron lore keeper.
Yay!
So if you're curious about that, if you're watching, go down to our little banner that says Patreon, check out all the different tiers, find one that suits you and help support the stream grow to something that, you know, would be super awesome for everybody. So we are out. We thank you so much for being a part of the family, and thank you, Bob, for getting us back to the Final Horizon. Thank you, James, Colby, Remy, everybody for being here and just making this dream come true. So I love all of you guys, and we love you. So be good to each other, be awesome, and beat hate with love.